Thank you so much for joining us at Lifepoint Church online. If God is using this ministry to impact your life, we would love to hear about it and encourage you to share your story at lifepoint.org/story. If you'd like to partner with us financially and help expand our reach all over the world with the good news of Jesus, you can do so by clicking the Give button at the bottom of the page and selecting the option that works best for you. Or you can use our text to give option by texting the keyword LifePoint and the amount to the number 45777. Again, thank you so much for joining us. We hope that you are encouraged by today's message.
We want to say good morning to all of our campuses and everyone joining us online. We're glad that you're here today. We are in week three of the series called The Me I Want to Be. And this is the idea that we've been talking about, is that there is a me I want to be, but there is the me that I am. I know who I am, but I also know who I want to be. And I said in week one that who I want to be is not always the best picture that I should be pursuing, because sometimes the me that I want to be is misinformed. It's a picture in my head. It's an ideal that maybe I could never attain to, that I couldn't possibly reach. And so maybe we should change out who I want to be and say, I want to be the who I am called to be. That God has a calling on every one of our lives, that it's not a thing for ministers, or it's not a thing for people in a church staff, that God has a call on every one of your life. And that you should be pursuing the you that you're called to be. That's who God wants you to be, is the you that you're called to be. And so how do we get from who I am to who I'm called to be, to live out this life where I'm fully alive, where I'm fulfilling the potential of God that's on the inside of me, that I'm living life to its fullest, that I'm being who I'm called to be? How do I do that? In week one, we said that you got to have some ability. And we talked through those. And last week we talked about you got to have focus, that what you focus on, you magnify, and what you magnify, you end up focusing on. So you got to magnify the right things in your life. And if you missed any of those, you should download the app and get them. And I think it'll be helpful to you. And you can stream and look at all of our messages on the app as well. So you should check that out. All right. How many of you have ever been to a store or somewhere that you frequent, and when you got there, they changed the layout on you? Yes, you got there, and they changed, like, it's your favorite place to shop or whatever. They changed the layout on you, and you walked in, you're kind of like, I don't know if I like this. Like, where's the sales rack? I always knew where the sales rack. That's the way it works in my house. Like, I already knew where the sales rack was. Where's that thing at, you know? Or you walked into a grocery store, and you're like, wait, the ketchup isn't on this aisle. It's on the other aisle. Like, I know where things are, and I like things to be where things are supposed to be, right? We like things to be a bit predictable. Somebody shout predictable. When I was a kid, we had a cat. I don't know why, because they come from the devil. But we had one, and if you're a cat person, don't email me. I won't read it anyways. We had a cat, and it mostly lived in the basement of our house. And sometime, spring cleaning would come, and my dad would, like, rearrange the basement or clean it up or get stuff out that got there all winter. And that cat, this is no lie, would, like, walk and mope around the basement just moaning. Like, not meowing, moaning. Like, making this horrendous moaning sound because things had got moved. The cat liked things to be predictable, right? And I would say that most of us, we like to live life that way. Like, we like the predictability of life. We find some comfort in it. We may find some safety in it. We find that we just like things. We kind of build our lives around being predictable. Somebody shout predictable. Predictable. But I would propose to you today that God didn't intend for you to live a predictable life. I'm not talking about a consistent life, like a life of integrity and a life of character. I'm talking about a life of predictability, where it's the same thing every day, all week, all month, all year, that God didn't design you. I would say that for you to pursue the call of God on your life will force you to live anything but a life of predictability. That the calling of God on your life will require some risk-taking, it'll require some adventure, it will require some unknowns, it will require this thing called faith for you to be able to live the call that God has on your life. And so it's anything but predictable. But most of us, we like things to stay the way that they are because we're a bit adverse to change. No matter how, like, forward-thinking you are, or no matter how, like, progressive and things that you like, most of us, the majority of us, there are adverse to change. Are you with me so far? Matter of fact, studies have been done about this, about how we process change. I'm going somewhere, so just hang with me. You're like, is he going to open the Bible? I will in a minute. Just chill out. Studies have been done about how we process change. For some of us, we process change by embracing change. Like whenever change comes, we embrace it. And matter of fact, about 16% or so of the population falls into this category. Some of you, when you think embrace change, like you're breaking out in hives right now. But 16% of the population, you're the people that last Friday, as soon as the iPhone 7 became available, like you were online pre-ordering it, you know. You're the people that camp out in front of a store to get the latest thing. You want the latest, the most updated. You're in that category. Matter of fact, you have something in you that needs change. Like you need it. Like for me, if things don't change, I lose interest. For me to stay interested in something, it's got to change. It's got to have motion. There's got to be movement about it. In my work environment, thankfully in my role, I can kind of dictate this. But like I would just oftentimes blow up my meeting schedule, which blows up everybody else's meeting schedule because I need change. I get disinterested. If it's the same meeting, the same time every week, I lose interest. Like I don't even want to be in it, and it's my meeting. Are y'all with me? That's a problem, right? I will mess up my schedule. I'll just move because I need change. Change invigorates me. Like I do want the latest thing. I do want the newest thing. Whatever the gadget is out, I want it yesterday. Are y'all following me? Come on, somebody. Anybody with me? That's 16% of the population or so. Some of us process change. We process change, which means that we're going to think about it. We're going to ask some questions. It's not bad. It's just how you deal with change. You're going to want to know some details. You're going to want to find out some information. You're going to want to have some meetings about it. You know, you work with these people. They want to have a meeting about the meeting about the meeting about the change. Come on, I want to shoot those people. I mean, I want to pray for them in the name of Jesus and bless them all the day long, right? But you have to process change, and it's not bad. You make up 68% of the population. So that's pretty much the majority, overwhelming majority of people that you know. And so you process it. You'll think about it a while. You'll eventually get around to getting the new thing. You'll eventually get around. You're not going to get it immediately, though. You're the person that's going to say, I'm going to let them work out all the kinks. What it means is you're not ready to change. You need a little bit of time to think about it, right? So you work a little. Then the last 16% of the population, you just resist change. You resist it altogether. Like you still have a flip phone. Come on, somebody. If you could, you'd still be listening to 8-tracks. If you don't know what an 8-track is, Google it. You don't use Google. Are you with me? So you wouldn't Google it because you're part of the 6. Like, you just don't want to change for the sake of not changing. Like, it's worked good up to this point, you know. Why should I change now? I've been wearing this long. I've had the same style this long. I drove this car this, you know, like you just don't want to change. But we all process change differently. However, the point at which most of us change is the same. Most of us change at the point of pain. Most of us change at the point of pain. There's a small minority of us that pursue change. But most of us don't change till it's the point of pain when it comes to things in our life. Not gadgets, not technology, but when it comes to things that matter. We don't change until pain enters the situation. Matter of fact, we don't change, as the saying goes, until the pain of remaining the same is greater than the pain of change. Because there's a pain to changing. Because the saying goes like this. Are y'all still with me? Okay, this is helpful. If you're a business leader, you should be taking notes. I gave you your staff meeting for the next month. Because change, all change, is loss on some level. And all loss is painful. Let me say that again. All change is loss on some level, and all loss is painful. Every time you change, you're giving up something for something else. You're exchanging something for something else. Are you with me? And there's some loss in that. And every time we lose something, there is an element of pain. This is true just naturally, right? If you want to lose weight, there's the loss of something, and it takes pain. Are you with me? But what you're gaining is greater, right? So you're willing to go through the pain in order to embrace what is on the other side of change. This is why Jesus said this, "For the joy set before him, he endured the cross." He was willing to go through the pain of the cross to get what was on the other side of the cross, which was you and me, the opportunity for us to be saved. Are you with me? So we're willing to push through the pain and through the change because what we see on the other side is worth it. So here's my question to you. What if you didn't have to wait until pain entered the situation in order to change? What if you changed because of vision? Now hang with me. Here's what I mean by that. What if you had such a vision of who it is that God has called you to be that you embraced change yourself, pushed through the pain of change because you saw something greater that you were willing to go after? Does that make sense? What if you got a good picture of who it is that God has called you to be and what it is that God wants for you and the plan that God has for your life? And what if you so magnified that? Do you see how these are building on each other? Now, what if you so focused on that and magnified that in your life that you were willing to say, I'm going to induce change on my life, not wait for it to be enforced on me, not wait till the pain becomes so great that I have to do something, that I'm forced to do something, that I just got to do something different, because if not, I'm going to die. But what if you were to say, no, I'm going to embrace incremental change alone in my life because I have such a vision of where I'm going. Right now, I'm training for a marathon. Don't be too impressed because it's painful right now, right? And I've somehow jacked up my IT band. If you'd please email my assistant, if any of you know how to fix my IT band, that would be awesome. But I've jacked up my IT band on my right knee somehow. And so being the hard head that I am, the first time it started hurting me was around 6 miles or so on a run a couple weeks ago. I was like, well, I got to push through the pain. Dumb idea. Because then I couldn't walk down steps the rest of the day. And that was on a Saturday. And I preach on Sundays, if y'all don't know it. And I didn't want to come here looking like a gimp in front of all y'all. So I was at home icing it and I was rolling. I was doing everything I could to it. But I have this vision of crossing the finish line. Are y'all with me? I had this vision of them putting the medal around my neck. I'm not saying I'm gonna be first, I'm gonna say I'm gonna finish. That's my goal in races, is to finish. But I have this vision of where I'm going, and so because I have this vision of where I'm going, I'm willing to make any change in my schedule, in my timing, in my diet, in whatever I'm doing. I'm willing to make all these changes along the way, and some of them are painful changes because of what I want at the end of the race. Are you following me? Can I tell you that your life is a race, and at the end of the race, you don't want to get to the race and have lost. You don't want to get to the end of your race and not have won. Or let me say it this way. You don't want to get to the end of your race and not have reached the full potential of all that God had for you because you were unwilling to embrace some change along the way. Is this helping? Are you hearing me? God has something great for you. You don't want to get to the end of the journey and say, wow, I missed my potential. I didn't become all that God wanted me to be in this life because I was unwilling to embrace some change. So this is the word we're going to work with today, is the word change. Somebody shout change.
Change.
I'm not talking about the change in your pocket. I'm talking about change that you need to make on the inside of you. And so I want to talk to you about three different types of change, but before I do, I think some of you may be in your head, if you've been around church for a while, you're like, well, I don't really want to change because I want to be like God and God never changes, right? You're like, well, why do I need to change? Because, you know, the Bible says, like in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, it says this, I, the Lord, do not, shout it,
change.
I, the Lord, do not change. Hebrews 13 says this, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if God is unchanging, then I want to be like God, then why should I change, right? Well, I want you to understand something because I don't want you to be biblically illiterate. I want you to have good understanding. That's talking about the character of God. That's referring to the character of God. And it is to our benefit that the character of God never changes. Because if he is forgiving yesterday, he is forgiving today, and he will be forgiving tomorrow. It is to our benefit that his character never changes. If he is loving today, he will be loving tomorrow, and he will be loving forever. It is to our benefit that his character, are you with me? That his character never changes. If his mercies are new every morning yesterday, then they're going to be new every morning today, and they're going to be new every morning forever. It's talking about his character, and it is to our benefit that the character of God never changes. Are you with me so far? However, how God works in the lives of his children does change. Because just as a loving father understands the personality and the makeup and the differences of each of his child and then parents them in order to lead them to a place where they move out and get their own job and, you know, are a contributing member of society, just as each parent would lead each child in a different way, so our Father works with us in a way that understands our personality, our makeup, because he created us. Are you with me? So the way God works in your life may not be the way that God works in my life. The way that God gets my attention may not be the way that God gets your attention. The way that God instructs me and the way that I hear God and the way, because I have a relationship with God. I don't have an organization with God. I don't have a religion with God. I have a relationship with God. So in this relationship with God, he works with me in a way that I get it. Are you with me? But if he works with you the way that I get it, you may not get it. And sometimes he works with me at two or three different angles. So sometimes I'm hard-headed, and sometimes I don't get it the first time. So sometimes he comes straight on with direct, and then sometimes he comes around this way, and sometimes he comes that way. And sometimes he uses rough circumstances, and sometimes he uses pain. Sometimes that's the only thing that gets my attention. Are you with me? And so how the character of God doesn't change, but how he works with us changes. Now, why is it important that the character of God doesn't change? Because God doesn't need to improve. You change because you need improvement. You change because you need to change out something you're currently doing for something that's better. A way you're currently thinking for something that's better. But God doesn't need to get better. Can I get an amen? Amen. God doesn't need to get better. However, you and I don't fall in that category. We need to get better. We need to improve. We need to grow. And if you're going to grow, you have got to change. Somebody shout it. You've got to
change.
You've got to change. And so I'm going to give you three areas where I believe that you've got to change. And then I'm going to give you one really good application to it. Number one is this, is you've got to change with your season. You've got to change with your season. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 through 13 says this. There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant, to uproot, to kill, to heal, to tear down, to build. Time to weep, time to laugh, to mourn, to dance. A time to scatter stones, a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain. A time to search and to give up, to keep, to throw away, to tear and to mend, to be silent and to speak. Somebody should write that down. You need that one. A time to love, to hate, time for war and peace. And what does the worker gain from all of his toil? I've seen the burden God has laid on men. He's made everything beautiful in its time. He's also set eternity in the hearts of men, yet they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know there is nothing better for men than to be happy and do good while they live, that everyone may eat, drink, and find satisfaction in all of his toil. This is the gift of God. Solomon is writing this. Solomon is David, King David's son. He's the king. And he's writing this. He wrote Song of Solomon. He wrote Proverbs. And he's writing this to tell us in that first season that there is a time or there is a season to everything in our life. There's a time for everything and a season for everything. You intuitively understand this, that there is a season in everything in life, right? Right, okay. That wasn't rhetorical. You understand there's a season in everything in life. There is a time to rejoice and there is a time to mourn. There's appropriateness in the season that you're in. There is a time to laugh and there is a time to cry. There is a time to build things up and there is a time to tear down things down so you can build something new up, right? There's a time for everything. In Ecclesiastes, Solomon is trying to get us to understand that there is seasons and times to everything. You know this about your life, right? You don't have to be an agriculturalist or a farmer or a green thumb to understand there's a time to plant, and then there is a time to grow, and then there is a time to harvest, right? There is a time. You understand that you don't plant a seed and then look at it and go, dumb seed, why aren't you grown up yet? Because you understand there's times to think. You understand that there is times in your life. There's a time when you're low on responsibility and low on authority, right? Are y'all with me so far? And then there is a time where you have great responsibility and authority in your life. And that grows. You understand that there is a time to be free and to have fun. And then there is a time to be responsible and pay your bills and lead your home, right? You understand there are times and seasons to everything. You know, there is a time when you are without kids, and then there is a time when you have kids, and then there is a time when they move out of your house, right? There is a time for that. There is a time for that. There is a time for that. It's 9 years for me for the first one. It's 18 for the one on the way. What was I thinking? I was seduced. That's what I said. It's my story. There's a time for everything. But I think most of us, maybe many of us, are living our life out of season. We live our life out of season. We're, I think, often one season behind. We're stuck in one season, and we haven't moved to the next. We haven't changed with our season. And so we're stuck in one season because it worked good. That season worked for us. We liked it. What we did worked. The routines we had worked. The thing we did, it worked. And so we stayed in that season when God was trying to move us on to the next season. And we're uncomfortable in this season, and we're frustrated now. We weren't frustrated, but now we are frustrated in this season because God's moved us, wanting to move us to another season, but we're stuck in this one. We're out of season. We're changing seasons right now, right? We're about to move into the fall season. Are you with me? If you didn't know that, I'm telling you, the fall season. We're moving into fall. And I love fall because I love football and I love fire pits. And I don't like s'mores right now because it doesn't fit in my plan. Right? Because I'm changing, because I got a vision of where I'm going. Get that met. All right. Anyways. And so I love watching my kids make s'mores over the fire pit. I love hoodies and shorts. If I could wear hoodies and shorts for the rest of my life, I would be fine. I love this weather. Hoodie, shorts, and some flip-flops. Come on, that is going to be the weather of heaven. I believe it in the name of Jesus. But I love fall and fall in Virginia. Like, there's no better place to be in Virginia in the fall than in Virginia. So I just love that. But here's the deal. If you were to wear what you wore in the summer into the winter, you would look kind of out of place. You would feel something. You would feel distressed. You would feel cold. You wouldn't feel right. It would feel uncomfortable. It felt very comfortable in the summer, right? Felt very comfortable in the summer because it was hot in the summer, and so you were dressed appropriate to the temperature in that season. But now you have moved into the winter season, and you're still wearing what you were wearing in the summer, and so now it doesn't feel appropriate. It doesn't feel right. It feels a little off because you're in a new season. Some of us live life that way. We're in one season, and we're dressed appropriately. We're operating appropriately. We're thinking appropriately for that season. But now God is trying to move us into a new season in life, and we're still trying to wear what we wore in the old season, and we're not changing with the season. I don't know if you're getting this, so let me break it down for you a little bit more. Some of us, we're wanting to be a season of leading. We're wanting to be in a season of promotion, and we don't understand why God hasn't given us the new job, promoted us to the new place, given us the new title, given us the upgrade, given us the new pay. And God is like, no, I got you in a season of learning, because you can't lead until you learn some things. I'm trying to teach some things to you in this season of learning so that you can get to the season of leading. And you're resisting the work of God in your life because you're trying to move into the wrong season. You got to be in the right season. So there are seasons of your life. There is a season for learning. There is a season for growing. There is a season for leading. There is a season to harvest. But if you are in a harvest season trying to plant, you're going to be out of season. And if you're in a planting season and you're trying to reap the harvest, you are going to be frustrated. Daniel chapter 2 says this, God changes the times and the seasons. God changes the times and the seasons. God doesn't work on the school calendar. God doesn't work on the fiscal calendar. God doesn't work on your calendar. God works on times. And see, if it would change your walk with Jesus, if you would understand God works in times and seasons. And they don't have a definitive beginning date, and they don't have a definitive ending date. He's trying to do something in you in the season. And if you'll embrace the season, get everything out of the season you need to get, then you can move on to the next season. How many of you ever feel like God's trying to teach you the same lesson over and over and over and over again? If you would learn the lesson, you could move to the next season. So many of us are out of season. Some of us, we parent out of season. You're trying to be their BFF and they need an authority figure. You're out of season. You're going to mess them up. They're going to need counseling. And we call on my staff, taking their time. Because you was out of season. We don't mind, but you'd help us out if you parent in season. Come on, you with me, somebody? You trying to be cool and post your selfies like you're in high school. You ain't in high school. You're a parent. Start adulting. Come on, somebody. Start adulting. We may make Lifepoint swag that says, start adulting. Lifepoint Church. It'll be a scoop neck V. We'll have them in regular shirts. We'll have them in the long t-shirts like this. And people are like, why are you wearing your gown to church? You still on a flip phone too, ain't you? You got to be in your season. And here's, if I could just, let me add this on for, just as an encouragement. Some of you are like, Pastor, I don't like my season. I'm in a hard season. Can I encourage you? It's just a season. It's not here to stay. It's just a season. So embrace what you can in the season. Let me say it this way. Get what you can out of the season. Get what you can out of it. Learn something. You know what would be horrible? Is for you to go through a season of growing and stretching and have nothing to show for it. I would not go through all the pain of training if I don't have something to show for it at the end of training. Why would you go through the pain of a growing season and not have anything to show for it? Get something out of the season. Are you with me? So number one, change with your season. Number two is change up. See what I'm doing there? Change up your approach. Mark chapter 10 verse 47, 48 says this. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more. In other words, he got louder. Son of David, have mercy on me. This is, if you've been around church, you know what we're this story, but if you haven't, this is about a guy named Bartimaeus, who was blind, and he was sitting on the side of the road, and he hears that Jesus of Nazareth is coming by, and he shouts out to him, Jesus, like loud, like Jesus. And his friends around him are like, Bart, shut up, man. Like, chill. Like, don't do that, right? And then it says he shouts all the more, Jesus! Ain't nobody asleep now. Somebody just woke up and they may have wet themselves. And if you did, you deserve it for sleeping on me. But he shouts all the more. He gets even louder, even though he's having opposition from the people around him. Now, this is just kind of conjecture and maybe where like kind of a holy imagination if I could on the text. We don't know this for sure. We don't have this in the written text, but I just kind of wonder if Bartimaeus wasn't there and he heard that Jesus was coming by and looked at the people around him and said, "Hey, would you get Jesus for me?" It's not like he could go find Jesus. He was blind. It's not like he could even see where Jesus was. He was blind. He just heard that Jesus was coming. And I don't know, but maybe his friends around him said, we're not going to go mess with the rabbi. I mean, look at the entourage he has with him. Thousands of people follow Jesus around. So he's got the 12 disciples. He's got the other 60 that were really close to him. And he's got thousands of people that are traveling with him. And he's passing through this town. And I don't know if somebody said, "Bartimaeus, man, don't mess with Jesus. Like, he ain't got time for you. He's got bigger things to deal with." And he's like, "No, man, come on, get him. I heard that he healed the blinded eyes at the guys at the pool, and he put mud on his eyes, and whenever he washed them off, he could see again. I want that to happen to me. I haven't been able to see ever, and if I could see, it would change my life, and my life would be so much different. I've got a vision of what it could be in my life, of where I could go in my life, of what could happen in my life. My eyes could be open. I could see things I've never seen. I could do things that I've never done. Just go get Jesus for me." And they're like, "No, just leave him alone." So Bartimaeus decides, "I'm going to change up my approach." And he goes, "Jesus!" He got a little radical. Have you ever been in an uncomfortable environment in public, like whenever someone's yelling? You know what I'm saying? Like, they're yelling, and it's definitely not appropriate to be yelling. And you're like, "Oh my goodness, what's happening?" You kind of want to look at them, but you don't want to look at them, you know? Your kids are, and you're like, "Stop staring. Stop staring now." Right? It's really weird, right? It's out of place. It's uncomfortable. It's awkward. It's not the norm. It's not in the flow with everybody else. But can I tell you something? If Bartimaeus hadn't have changed up his approach, Bartimaeus would have been blind till he died. But he was willing to do something a little radical. He was willing to try something new. He was willing to push the envelope. He was willing to change up his approach because what he had been doing had not gotten him what he wanted in life. What he had been doing didn't get his blinded eyes open. So he decided, "I'm going to change up my approach. Jesus, have mercy, Son of David." Starts yelling at him. He changed up his approach. Can I tell you something in life? That for many of us, if you are going to go from who you are to who God has called you to be, you may have to get a little radical. You may have to push the envelope a little bit. You may have to get out of your comfort zone. You may need to change up your approach a little bit. You may need to worship a little bit more passionately. You may need to pursue Jesus a little bit more desperately. Are you following me this morning? You may have to change up your approach if you want to keep getting what you've been getting, keep doing what you've been doing. But if you don't live a life that is fully alive, living out the calling of God on your life, then maybe you should try something new. What happened when Jesus went up to the man with the crippled hand? He looked at him and he said, "Stretch out your hand." That man had never stretched out his hand because his hand was crippled. Jesus said, "Try something new. Try something out of the norm. Do something you've never done before. Step out of your comfort zone." But here's what I found out is that most of us don't get radical. I'm not saying crazy. I'm not saying stupid. Are you with me? People that are like, "You know, that person, like, they're like, they talk about the Holy Spirit and they're weird and I don't want to become like that." They were weird before they ever came to church. Are y'all with me? They're weird before they ever came to church, all right? So don't blame the weirdness on the Holy Spirit. It's just who they are. Love them anyways. But I found that most people won't try something new until they're desperate. Why would you wait until God has to use the tool of desperation to get you to change to pursue what he wants for you in your life? I'm not saying God sends circumstances into your life that get you to the point of desperation, but I'm saying God will use every circumstance in your life to push you and to move you and to lead you to who you're called to be. Why wouldn't you just initiate that yourself? Why wouldn't you just begin to say, "God, I'm so hungry for you. And God, I want you to cause my hunger to grow. God, I'm going to come in. I'm going to try something new. I'm going to come to church on time. Because I'm hungry for something new. I'm going to engage in worship like I've never engaged in worship before. I'm going to pursue you. I'm going to go after you, God. I'm going to try. I'm going to do something new. Don't even start on that level. Just start on I'm going to like take a different route to work in the morning. Like I'm just going to, you know, if you need basic small incremental steps, start there, because most of us live our life out of routine. And I would say there's a fine line between routine and rut. If we were really honest, we live our life in a rut. Do we not? Tell me if this sounds anything like your life. Get up. Go to work. Come home. Watch the news. Eat something. Go to bed. Get up. Go to work. Come home, watch the news, eat something, go to bed. Get up, go to school, go to practice, come home, do homework, maybe. Eat something, go to bed. Get up, go to work. Sit in traffic. Come home. Eat something. Go to bed. Get up. Mow the yard. Clean the garage. Watch some football. Take a nap. Eat something. Go to bed. Get up. Go to church. Sit in the auditorium. Get back in my car. Go to lunch. Watch some football and fall asleep. Eat something unhealthy. Go to bed. So I can get up. Go to work. Come home. Are y'all with me? Well, I like routine. That's called a rut. Do something different. You got to change your approach. If you want something different, you got to do something different. Bartimaeus was like, I'm desperate enough for what Jesus has for me. I'm desperate enough to have my eyes open to see that I'm willing to try something new. I'm willing to do. If I could do anything today, I would want to just shake every one of you and go, do something new this week. Get up in the morning a little bit early and read your Bible. Pray a little bit. Put a CD of worship on your way to work. Well, I don't have one. Well, go to iTunes right now and download every LifePoint album you can find. I'm going to listen to worship on the way to work. I'm going to drive a different way. Next Sunday, I'm going to come in here and I'm going to do something different. I'm going to get as close as I can. I'm going to worship as passionately as I can. I'm going to get on a serving team. I'm going to join a group. I'm going to start to give. I'm going to do something different. Jesus, have mercy. I'm going to do something. I'm going to change my approach because I want something different. I want to shake you out of your rut, because a rut, as I heard one old preacher say, is a grave with the ends knocked out. You're not living life. Come on. You're not living life. You're not living life fully alive. You're existing. God called you to so much more than existing. If I don't do anything beneficial in your life, may I push you to a place where you don't just exist. Get up. Go to work. Come home. Really? Is that what you want to go before God? What'd you do on the planet? I got up. I went to work. I came home, I sat in traffic, I watched football. They lost a lot. I ate dinner, I went to bed. You really want that to be your finish line? Do you really want that to be what it is? I want to get to the finish line and go, I raised great children. I impacted the world with the gospel. I made a difference in the community around me. I built something with my life. Are y'all with me? I didn't live in a routine. I changed my approach. And in every season, I got a different approach. If that one wasn't working, I got something new. And if that didn't work, I tried something new. But some of us never change our approach because this way has worked for us so far. Has it really worked? I base what's working on what it produces. Is it producing what you want? More importantly, is it producing what God wants for you? Let me give you one more thought on this. The nation of Israel, they were enslaved for 400 years in Egypt, right? Just nod your head. I'm telling you the truth. They were enslaved for 400 years. Do you know when they got out of slavery? This is rhetorical. They got out of slavery when they asked for it. Read your Bible. 400 years in slavery. You know when they got out of slavery? When they cried out to God. And when they cried out to God, what did God do? He spoke to Moses at a burning bush. Now that's awesome, but here's my question. Why didn't the other generations ask to get out? How many kids lived and grown up with a slave mentality because their parents wouldn't change their approach? Why didn't the first generation cry out to God to get out? Why didn't the second generation cry out to God? Why did it take 400 years of people living for someone to wise up enough to go, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we're your people, set us free. As soon as they prayed it, God began working. What will it take for you to change your approach? What will it take for you to change your approach? What will it take for you to get so desperate for God to do something new and fresh in your life that you cry out to Him? Say, God, I want what You want for me. I want to be all that You've called me to be. I want to change. Don't wait until the pain of remaining the same is greater than the pain of change. Embrace the change. Embrace the change. Somebody shout change.
Change.
Finally, change with your season. Change with your season. Change up your approach, right? And the last one is change out your position. Change out your position. Look what Proverbs says. It says, he who walks with the wise grows wiser, but a companion of fools suffers harm. Look what it says in the New Testament. The Apostle Paul wrote this. He said, don't be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. When I was a student pastor, that was like my go-to verse. Listen to me, boys. Bad company corrupts good character. Make sure you got good friends. Can I tell you that applies to adults just as much? The destiny that you reach is determined by the connections you have. Let me say it this way. The quality and the direction of your life are determined by the people that are around you. In every campus, at every auditorium, you're positioned around some people. You got some people positioned around you, right? But in life, you have people positioned around you as well. I'm not talking about just the people that you kind of know, acquaintances. I'm talking about those people that are like in the inner circle. The people that like can speak freely into your life. The people that love you and you love them and you get them and they get you. They got your back and you're got. I'm talking about those people. Those are the people that are going to determine your destiny. And they're doing one of two things in your life. They're either accelerating you towards the call of God on your life, or they're derailing you from the call of God on your life. There is no middle ground. Because you're either moving forward or you're moving backwards. And they are either helping you do one or the other. You're either accelerating towards your call and becoming all that God wants you to be, or the people in your life are derailing you from all that God has called you to be. I'm not talking about the people you're wanting to to loving the people that need you. I'm not talking about that. You don't cut yourself off. This isn't like I'm better than everybody else. I'm talking about those people that you led into your inner circle. Are you with me? And for some of you to move to the next level that God wants to take you, you've got to be willing to change up your position, where you have positioned yourself and the people you have positioned around you. See, I believe this. I believe that God wants to take you to greater and greater levels in your life. But I believe He'll allow you to stay at the level you settle for. And the place you settle is based on the level of change you're willing to embrace. So if you're willing to change to go to the next level, but you don't want to go beyond that, you'll stay there and God will allow you to stay there. He's not going to force you. And for some of you, this is the sticking point in your life. This is the sticking point in you becoming all that God has called you to be. Because either A, you think, well, I can do it by myself. I got this. I can do it by myself. But can I tell you that the Christian life isn't meant to be lived in isolation? You can't do it alone. Because your assignment isn't fulfilled until you have the right alignment first. What I mean by that? You've got to align yourself with the right people. Because it's in the alignment of the right people that God reveals your greater destiny. Are you with me? It doesn't matter. Let me say it this way. It doesn't matter how good I could preach or how great I could lead. If I had not aligned myself around the right people, we would not be where we are today. If I had not continued to align myself at each season and each moment of the church, if I hadn't aligned myself with the right people above me, the right people around me and beside me, then we would not be where we are today, because I understood that my destiny was found in relationship with others. That I couldn't fulfill the call of God on my life by myself. I had to do it in community with other people. And the same is true for you. Your destiny, hopefully your destiny is somehow tied to me. Hopefully we're somehow tied. Hopefully you come in here every week. And somehow because of this alignment with me, your assignment is getting broader and broader. But can I tell you something? It can't just be me and you on Sunday. You got to find some people around you during the week that will pour into you and love you and celebrate you. You got to have some people that'll pray with you, because good company helps good character, but bad company will create bad character. You'll become the average of the closest people in your life. And so are the people in your life accelerating you or derailing you? If they're not accelerating you, then you need to get some new close friends. Well, that's scary. Well, change is scary. Well, it could be awkward. Well, change is awkward. Remember? Jesus! But you got to do what you've never done to get what you've never had. And so here's what I want you to apply this today. Is what area of your life needs to change? What approach do you need to change? And I would say today, if you're not in a group, we've created this whole environment just for you to get connected to a group. This is the application. Maybe you need to change something. Change from just coming on a Sunday to coming on a Sunday and going to a group. But I'm introverted. Me too. I don't like to share how I feel. Me too. I've got a busy schedule. Me too. My kids have a busy schedule. Me too. But every Monday night, I make my way over to the Park House's house, and I sit in a circle, and I experience group, where I'm not a leader, I'm just me. I'm not the pastor. I'm just me. It's my safe place. You need that too. If I need it, you need it. I mean, I spend time with Jesus all week. That's all I do. Some of y'all believe that. That's all I do, Brent. I get up and I read the Bible all day long. and I pray and I meditate and I... If I need a group, you need a group. And if I can do it with my schedule and my personality, then you can do it. Because the people around you who you align with will help you get to your assignment. And so maybe today you would do something different so you could get something different. And they'll help you with all your questions. Well, what night of the week? I need childcare. I don't need childcare. I like this. I don't like that. I'm going to walk up to somebody's house. Yeah, it'll be awkward the first time. Let's just say it. It'll be weird. But after the first time, it'll be okay. We don't let people lead groups that are crazy. All right, y'all with me? I mean, one may slip through the crack, but you tell us. We'll kick them out. So at every campus, here's what I want you to do today. Let's take this message and apply it how God is speaking to you. And maybe, just maybe, for some of you, it's that you need to change your position. You need to go from isolation, from just me, myself, and I, me and my family, into community. And you know what you'll find out? Is that in community, your calling will be revealed and your calling will be fulfilled. Will you pray with me? At every campus, I want to give you a moment between you and God just to consider the word and evaluate what is God saying to you. What needs to change? Then number two, what are you going to do about it? Whatever he's saying to you today, don't put it off till tomorrow. Because whatever you put off till tomorrow is probably what you put off yesterday as well, till today. Don't keep kicking the can down the street. Do what it is God is calling you to do. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you that you invite us to embrace change for our benefit and for our good. Because you're shaping and molding us and wanting us to become more and more and more like Jesus. And so may every one of us respond in the way that you've spoken to us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Let's thank God for his word today, church. Come on.